Welcome to the Engineering Manager Podcast. I'm your host, Steven Tijamalia. Today we have a special episode focusing on cutting edge topic in data engineering, migrating to Apache Iceberg. We're thrilled to have Pankaj, Saikia, and Praveen, Rachabattuni, co-founders of Datafarer, join us today. They bring a wealth of experience and knowledge in data engineering, analytics, business intelligence. Welcome, Pankaj and Praveen.
Hey, hi.
It's good to have both of you.
Thank you, Stephen.
Oh, it's great to have both of you. Super excited for this session. You know, before we jump in, this is a topic people are thrilled to hear about, especially in the engineering manager community. It's a up-and-coming technology that people are using. But before we dive in, I'd like to have the audience kind of get to know both of you better. So Pankaj, let's start with you. Can you tell us a bit about your background and how you started in data engineering?
Yeah, so I began my career in the early 2000s. I joined a company called Cognizant Technology Solutions as a ETL developer and basically working in the BI and data warehousing space. And slowly I started working with multiple databases. Over the course of time, I changed a couple of corporations, companies, and moved across geographies, then walk across domains from, starting from retail to fintech, and then and slowly parked myself in the data and analytics space for quite some time. Then over a course of time, what I seen is like towards the middle of 2015, three things happened in the data world. So one is like increased penetration of smartphones, which was creating a lot of digital data. Then slowly the corporations also want to digitalize their own business processes. So that also gained some kind of traction. Then also a rapid rise of cloud solutions we saw, like, you know, they were the kind of a go-to data platform, and a lot of companies showed interest to move their on-premise data to cloud for better management, efficiency, scalability, and all these critical features. And a third was that, you know, there was a kind of a rising interest in automation and also artificial intelligence. And also a big hype got also created, which is still there. I mean, obviously, you know, people are kind of, you know, seeing some results on that. So which means data engineering became a kind of a very critical piece in the computing world. So you need data for all these three. I mean, all these processes create data or need data. So for me, who is from a data background and working on a data with so long, I mean, it is only a natural, you know, progression to the data engineering field. So that's how I am working in the data engineering right now. And that's my
well, thanks for sharing that. I mean, impressive background. Praveen, what inspired you to work in this data engineering field?
Sure. So prior to starting on the data engineering, so I was working as a web backend programmer, primarily using Python. And also I was building iPhone applications using Objective-C. So while I was doing that, so I was like always reading about how systems are scaled at a large scale, like through blogs like High Scalability and Hacker News. And that really got me curious about like scaling large scale systems. And that's where I think you get to apply like a lot of your computer science lessons and the concepts that you learn from your CS classes. So around that time, about 2013, I was working for a company called Sigmoid. The company was just setting up a big data team, and then I've joined the team and started exploring on Apache Spark, and Spark was just had a public release then as part of the Apache incubating project, and started out initially on Spark and also Hadoop, Hive, and Pig, and various other big data technologies. And it's been an exciting journey in the data engineering to space since then.
Thanks for sharing that. We have two powerhouse engineers with us today. And I, before we dive in and, you know, learn so much from you, I'd like to ask you one more question, and it's just so people get to know you a little bit more. And any hobbies you'd like to share with us, or interests outside of work? Pankaj, why don't we give us any hobbies you have, just so people get to know you better?
Yeah, so I am into kind of, you know, exercising, yoga and meditation. And I also play cricket with my son, who is almost like 10 years old right now. So spend quite some time during the week to play cricket. And then more than that, I can kind of, you know, love reading books. I mean, reading across genres and kind of, it is not only technical books. It's like, you know, kind of philosophy, psychology books, arts books. So that, you know these areas better. And then also probably to connect the dots across these areas. And also it helps me to know myself better, because people say like, and if you read books, you know yourself much better. So that's my current occupation outside of work.
Love it. That's great. And then Praveen, any hobbies you'd like to share with us?
Yeah. So yeah, like when I'm not at desk, so I'm mostly like spending time with my kids. So I have two younger kids. The eldest one is less than 3 years old. And yeah, I mean, like a lot of times it can be quite exhausting experience with having young kids. But then it's also like quite energizing and exciting to watch them play, and the enthusiasm they put into any activity that they're doing. And apart from that, so I also like to travel. So that's something I find exciting. And also like reading nonfiction books. That's something that I enjoy. And yeah, like lately, last year, I kind of got a new mirrorless camera. So I kind of try to photograph landscapes and yeah, whenever I find time.
Well, it sounds like you guys know how to have fun, good family time. Let's get into Datafarer a little bit more. You started this company out. You've been very successful with it so far. Tell us a little bit about what it does. Give us some background, and you know, Pankaj, I could let you start, and then Praveen, feel free to add anything you like into it.
Yeah, so Praveen and I started Datafarer, which is a kind of a data engineering consulting company focusing on, it's a basically a boutique company, like two of us started. And it's mainly focused on some niche areas where we can kind of focus on based on our interest and where the trends are kind of, you know, going. So how we started? So we started this company this year. So I was working in a full time till some time back, and then we started doing freelancing and across projects. It is a kind of a fruitful journey, but it was kind of a little bit, you know, solo and a little bit lonely. So one fine day, I was kind of you know, messaging in Slack and in a public forum, and then got hold of Praveen. Like, you know, he also shared a similar journey, that he also doing freelancing, and then we thought, hey, you know, why not kind of sync up and know about each other. So this conversations happened over a period of time, like over days and weeks, and then like what his focus is, what his experience is, and what he aspired to do. Then we found a lot of commonalities there, and then we thought that, you know, let's give some structure and give some visibility on our aspirations, experiences, and skills. So which means, you know, did a soft launch of a consulting company. So that's how we started, and then we kind of thought like where to focus on. I mean, data engineering is a very, very vast field, and only two of us starting out. It's a kind of a really, really a kind of not a very easy thing. I mean, sometimes you feel really overwhelmed, like where to start with. Then we kind of went through our connections and meet our old friends, clients, and companies we worked with. Then and I showed our interest that, hey, we are kind of starting off as a company, and we'd want to kind of contribute what we know best and kind of add value, create value, and seek value, and also feel valued. So that's how we kind of got a few projects, and that's how kind of we are kind of working on right now.
And mainly our focus right now is on open source software, which is cost effective, which is flexible, and where you know, clients kind of have shown interest to adopt.
Great. And then if you keep holding that mic where it is, it always makes it sound a lot better. So good job. Now, Praveen, you know, Pankaj talked about open source, and that's an area you focused on. I know you have a lot of experience in Apache Spark. Can you share with us the journey and your experience with Apache Spark?
Yeah, sure. I started on Apache Spark around 2013, and then the Spark 1.2 version was still not there yet. There was a little documentation available on the web about how you could use Apache Spark. So, I mean, that way that it required going through the code most of the time to like whenever you were stuck in some problem, so you would have to refer the code to find the solution. So that got me to better understand the internals of the Spark and how it is working, and then really have gain more confidence on the internals of Spark. And I originally started on the SQL module of Spark. So back then, the SQL was not part of the original Spark project, but it was a separate project, and later on got integrated into the Spark project itself. And it was not very easy to get both the modules working together because compatibility was so you would have to make sure you get the right versions of both these modules to get them working. Otherwise, they would just fail. It was not an easy thing to set it up back then. But over the time, it's much, much better and much easier now. And whenever you get into any trouble, the community, the Spark user group or the developer group was quite active, and anytime you post a question, so you might hear it back from the core committers or contributors to answer your question. So that was quite encouraging to see from the community. And apart from using the SQL module, so we were also looking at other projects like Hive and Thage, which also started integrating with Spark, and that is where we kind of thought about integrating Pig with Spark, and then started off on that. I'll talk more about that in some time.
Go ahead though. Since you're on that note, can you tell us a little bit more about that contribution to Pig on Spark open source project and your early experimentation with Spark?
Yeah, sure. Originally before the Spark came up with something like Data Frames API, you'll have to build your transformations using RDDB APIs primarily. And then using RDD APIs sometimes can be a bit tricky, once you have the full pipeline, you might see some of the transformation is not exactly correct, and then it's not scaling well, and then you'll have to get to the nitty-gritty software to get it correct. And also there is a challenge of learning scale up, which is a functional language, and a lot of times, people have started learning Scala just to get going with Spark, and Scala sometimes can be a bit challenging. So those are the kind of challenges while using the Spark APIs, the native APIs, and then kind of observed that there could be a good value in integrating Pig script. So which is very well adopted in the ecosystem back then, where the Pig script was much straightforward, and it's the language as is built more in terms of operating with data and building data pipelines. So initially we started out getting the support for the basic functions of Pico and Spark, and then we kind of put it out there, so shared about our project on the community, and then we had like a lot of positive comments from the community, and that's how like we started contributing and committing on the Pico and Spark project.
Thank you for sharing a lot of that. I'd like to hear a little of the challenges, because as the engineering manager community is embarking on these integrations and use, that helps them understand what challenges and how to overcome them. Are there any general challenges in creating and deploying Spark pipelines that you want to add to what you already said? I know you mentioned some, but you may want to cover a couple more, and then how you overcame them. That would be very helpful.
Yeah, sure. When you start building out pipelines and transformations using Spark, one thing you might want to keep an eye on is the amount of data that you get to read from the storage. Like a lot of times, the data read can be the most costliest operation, where the read time, be it from disk, like even from HDD or SSD, can be quite time taking. And then that way you would have to like limit the amount of the data that is being read as much as possible. That is where you see file formats like Parquet are really helpful. They are built in a columnar fashion. And then that way, any transformations that they do, you only get to read that particular columns. So when you have like a lot of columns, that really saves a huge amount of data when you go with the right data format like Parquet, particularly when you have analytical operations working in your pipelines. So that is one, like getting the right data format. And the second, I would say, is keeping an eye on the data shuffle. Make sure when you're building the pipelines, keep an have the Spark dashboard open, and then see the different stages, and then the shuffle between the stages, and make sure there is a reasonable shuffle, and then not some uncommon behavior where you see a very huge shuffle. Like sometimes you might have to make sure the parameter of the reduced partitions that is being set right. So in order to have the right number of tasks to work on the shuffle. So that is one, usually one parameter or the configuration that I kind of tune. Apart from that, so when you're working on the parameters or the configurations, make sure you're not adjusting too many parameters at once. Otherwise, so that can lead to a lot of confusion. You would want to, whenever you're tuning something, tuning a configuration, make sure you really understand and do what is needed, rather than changing all the configurations at once. So, and also one of the another common problem is that in one of the AI use case that we worked with, where we had to perform a dedupe operation on the data. So there, we originally built the transformation using the Spark ML library API called Approx Near Neighbor. And then we found as we increased the data, so it was not scaling really well. And then the shuffle was really, really high in terms of terabytes. And then we had to work on the actual logic, and then have a custom logic to compute the near neighbor. So sometimes you would have to actually change your logic before you deploy the pipelines into production. So I think, so these are some common approaches that I would consider when deploying in pipelines.
Thanks for sharing with us. And, we're going to jump into a couple other open source technology. Before I leave that, You started adopting Spark quite early when it was this beta version. How do you see the Spark project evolve over the next year or so?
Over the years, the stability of the project has improved many folds, and you would see that you would no longer see your pipelines breaking as easily as it was during the early times. It's much easier to build pipelines now, and they are more stable. That's where you would see that it's like a de facto standard out there for building like large transformations, and it's heavily integrated into any of the cloud providers like AWS, Azure, Google Cloud. It's also integrated into like a lot of managed services, and it is readily available to deploy. Over the years, there is a huge adoption of the project, and then the ease of use for developers is way better, and that is good to see overall.
Well, appreciate those insights. Pankaj, let me go a little bit to you. Tell me a little bit about the adoption of open source software and data engineering in the current context.
Yeah, if we look at the data engineering landscape,
you want to put your mic closer.
So if we look at closely the data engineering landscape right now, we see umpteen number of tools which have developed, through the open source world, or somebody has developed in house and saw some results and they have kind of open sourced it. So there are two ways of kind of looking at that. So in that realm, what we see is like the data is growing very rapidly over a couple of years, and everyone is looking for a flexible and cost-effective solutions. So when we talk to our recent clients, what we have seen is like they are showing a lot of interest in that, in saying that, hey, we want to build a particular piece, and how cost-effectively you can kind of build it and using open source. Because three things open source provide. I mean, one is a freedom, so to develop this, and then the code is kind of open sourced, and there is a big developer community which kind of fine tune this code or build additional functionalities, and then provide a good support on that. Other is that because these technologies are up to date and they are much closer to the real life problems in the cutting edge problems, and so they have those features built in, and then they also can be customized to some very very specific needs. So going by that, what we see is like open source enables a lot of agility and innovation in that space. But when we talk to the customers, they also closely tell us that that they don't want to get locked into a single vendor or a single solution. So say something, they built a lot of things, and then say the cost goes up, and it's very difficult to move from one vendor to another, because that will need to initiate another project to migrate or port everything. So here in that field, they say, hey, can you build something on open source so that we can kind of dabble in it, bring the functionality, see how the results are, and closely monitor that without focusing too much on the vendor locking and stuff like that. So in that piece, what we see is Apache Iceberg. It is one OSS solution which we see kind of getting traction, and customers are coming to us saying that can you use this particular open source metadata management tool or the open table format to make better use of our data, because our data is kind of growing kind of manifold, and we are seeing a lot of challenges on the consistencies and the data retrieval. Can you kind of do some POCs around that, or try to see how best we can use it. So Apache Iceberg, as we know, like it's an open table format, and it also gives some features like say schema evolution and data versioning, which are pretty critical when data grows at a very high pace, and the data becomes very very diverse. So nobody wants to kind of get that data layer got broken or do too many changes, because once the data is kind of relatively stable, the engineers can build pipelines and do a lot of things on top of it. So there where we see open source, I mean, this is one of the examples, but there are other examples as well. But because we have worked a project on around that, so we are just giving an example.
Now, if you could give me a little, you mentioned Apache Iceberg. I know that's an area that people, it's up and coming, it's getting a lot more traction. Can you give us a brief overview of Apache Iceberg and why it's important for data engineering?
So Apache Iceberg is an open table format. So it is mainly designed for large analytic data sets. So it can address a lot of data at scale. So if your data is kind of at a petabyte level and it's constantly growing and it is also becoming very diverse, meaning we see 10 attributes today and tomorrow we see like, you know, five other attributes coming in, and you need a kind of a table format to manage that data, both at data level as well as at metadata level. So there where Iceberg kinds of bring in lot of features and it provides solutions to tackle these problems. So if we kind of give a background, so it was basically developed in Netflix. So Netflix guys, that the engineers there, they face some problems with their Hive tables. So for example, Hive had some drawbacks or limitations as far as, you know, atomicity and consistency and all these critical database features. So they had challenges because it's a basically a file, not a pure play database. So you have to kind of have a table format to read that data. Now because those like even version control was not there. So when these drawbacks they faced, say they thought of building a table format which can kind of have those features like version control and your schema evolution features. So they saw very good results within their company, and then at one point of time they actually open sourced it, and it became a kind of a right now one of the top, you know, open table format in the data engineering field. So basically, if we look at the features, it provides a very high-level abstraction and then supports schema evolution and partitioning in a much better way to manage underlying, you know, data structures, file structures mainly. So it has the inherent ability to handle both append and update operations, you know, especially for you know, stream processing or real-time processing. So from that point of view, because in data engineering, one of the major problem we face is in data management, you know, optimizing query performance, and then make the data scalable and make it also consistent, because there are too many engines coming in, you know, say for there is one say reader writer process writing something, concurrent process, there's another reader process reading it, and if it is not maintained properly or the metadata management is not properly done, table management is not done, there is a chance of getting kind of corrupt data and inconsistent data, which nobody would like to have it. So from that point of view, I see like it's a good open table format which is interoperable, meaning it can work on any kind of engines. So earlier all the individual engines had their own proprietary data format. And then each of these proprietary data format has had their own limitations. So now we have a common format which can work on top of different kind of files and allow users to kind of, you know, maintain the data better. And the engineers primarily, they don't have to worry much about how to manage that, you know, the granular data layer. So they can kind of give those things to the Apache Iceberg to maintain the retrieval and the management, and they can just focus on building applications. I mean, they still have something to do, but a major work can be taken up by Apache Iceberg.
Now, that's an excellent overview, Pankaj. And Praveen, I just want to dive into one of the areas that Pankaj talked about, which are some benefits Apache Iceberg has over traditional data formats. I know Pankaj, you mentioned some, but you know, if we can go deeper a little into that, that way people listening can know why they really should go with Apache Iceberg.
Yeah, sure. So yeah, like Pankaj has mentioned, so there are some shortcomings with using IO Metastore and the way the partitions are being managed in Hive, where when the data has to be inserted or updated or deleted, so you would change the entire partition. And then like when you're working on when you're writing a partition, and then you would have another compute engine trying to read or another job that is trying to read the same partition, so that can be troublesome, which can lead to data inconsistencies and or even might lead to pipeline failures. So that is something that you would want to avoid. So Iceberg helps in tackling that problem, where it acts as a intermediate layer between the compute engine and the actual data format, where it kind of acts as a gateway whenever you're trying to read or write. So that way the writes and reads are like more consistent, and the data, the reliability of the data is much better with the Iceberg. And apart from that, so like Iceberg also provides you a declarative way of how the data is being managed for a table. Like you could have the file size, like the optimized file size configured. And that way you could make sure that all the files have a similar size, and which would improve the performance of transformations way better. So, and also like whenever you are like adding or dropping columns, so that is something that's something not easy like when you're doing that, where for data engineers they would have to have a plan, like whenever they are changing the schema of existing tables, like and then it would require like a lot of downtime before you could change the columns, because the whole data has to be rewritten, and it can be like quite compute intensive also. And so Iceberg can help whenever you have to correct the schemas, where the schema is managed at a metadata level rather than at the data level. So that way, whenever you have to make any changes to the schema, it's just acting on the metadata layer. And it's that way it is much, much easier with Iceberg. And also, yeah, so the support for different compute engines is much better with Iceberg, where the different compute engines wouldn't require their own proprietary format to read the data. They could all leverage the same data that is only written once. And again, that could save like a lot of compute by avoiding multiple ingestion operations. When you're trying to use compute engines like Trino or like ClickHouse or Dreamio or StarRocks, so all of these engines could use the same data that is available in your ClickHouse. And also like you get to see like a lot of Python libraries that get used in for building AI models. So they could use something like PyIceberg to read the data. So that way the duplication of the data is avoided, and also that will save like a lot of maintenance effort.
That's great. And we have so many questions to go through. We won't cover all of them, but I just want to kind of get this deep dive into Apache Iceberg. So thank you for those insights. But Kaj, I know Praveen, he dwelled a little bit into Apache Iceberg, how it handles data versioning and schema evolution. Can you just dive into that one a little bit more so those listening can get a better feel for Apache Iceberg and its capabilities?
So let me talk about the version control and schema evolution. So what is version control? So basically you have a data set today. Now data set can undergo umpteen number of changes. So a lot of inserts might happen, updates, deletes, all this can happen over a period of time. So for example, there's a 50 changes happening. So you need to figure out that what all 50 changes have taken place, when and how. So how you would track it? So you track it via the metadata management. So how metadata management tracks this? So it creates snapshots. So every time a data changes, so metadata will kind of create a snapshot and then keep it there. So at one point of time, you say, hey, 6 months back, something got changed. Now we need to correct it. Now what change? You want to track that change. So what we will do? You'll go to and look at those snapshots, and then look at like. I mean, basically, you can track the changes looking at those snapshots. And Apache Iceberg kind of have this capability to create snapshots of that those changes. So that is on the data versioning. So it's basically you can do any kind of rollback. You can look back. Basically, you can look back, roll back all these things. You can do by data versioning by looking at those snapshots. And the schema evolution. The schema evolution is something like I have 100 attributes today. Now tomorrow, 50 new attributes got added or something got dropped and you don't have any control. I mean it's basically an open thing. So you cannot have a kind of a strict schema to capture those. The schema keeps changing, so you don't maintain a schema. But how that schema evolution you will be able to track and trace. So basically what happens is that the metadata management, the whole Apache Iceberg by itself, it actually tracks those schema changes. And you know, so that only the relevant data files are kind of say applied and the existing data don't get touched. Basically, if the schema evolves, you don't have to break that data. So basically you just kind of make sure that data is data, but the way you retrieve the data, the way you kind of seamlessly move into that schema, the change in schema, that remains intact. So that's one of the inherent feature of Apache Iceberg, that is like now schema evolution, which means it's basically forward looking. So every time you say that, hey, if my schema changes, I don't have to kind of break the data, but my tool, my metadata management by Apache Iceberg will automatically take care of itself. So I don't have to worry about it. So there's some technical nitty-gritties, which we can kind of maybe it's too technical here. And so I just just to mention these two and how it happens at a very high level.
No, thank you for sharing those. And I know from this one, as you're looking to for those listening, looking to embark on a data engineering project with Spark, Apache, Iceberg, or overall data engineering with open source, we have two experts here that, as you can hear, giving out the lay of the land, the gotchas, what to do to overcome those. Praveen, before we jump on, I just want one more question to get you to talk about performance, discuss the performance improvements that Iceberg brings to data processing and querying, because that is another concern people may have. Can you dive into that a little bit more?
Sure. So in terms of performance, Iceberg can be quite helpful with all the metadata information that it manages. Like for example, like when you have like a sales data with you, and then when you have to do like a lot of filtering on based on the product category, for a query pattern like that, so you could have metadata maintained over the product category column, and where you would have indexes over that particular column about the min and max of every data file that is there, and that is something that could be maintained. And when you're performing a filter operation, so the compute engine could leverage that information basically, and then use that meta information to skip the data files. So that way, you're only getting to read that particular files which have the actual data, and then skip the rest. So that like really improves the performance. And apart from that, so one other feature that is not fully adopted with a lot of compute engines, but it's available in a few, is data sketches data. So that is available through Puffin file formats. So where you could have data like a number of testing values over a column. So you could you could have that data pre-computed and then stored in this Puffin file format. And then like when you have operations like join, they could use that data like the number of based on the number of data the distinct values, the plan could be optimized in a much better fashion where you could choose to broadcast the data with the smaller distinct values, and then you would see a drastic performance like with that. And like right now, we see this being a feature readily available through Redshift Spectrum along with the Glue catalog. And we hope to see more such performance gains while adopting Iceberg format.
Well, I appreciate we're coming down on time here, but for those companies that are starting their data engineering projects, looking at Iceberg, what is the best way for them to get a hold of you, to engage with you? What recommendations do you have for them as they're trying to get expertise and help? And I'll let both of you answer that.
Yeah, sure. We are working with different companies in setting up their own data stack. Like we get to try to spend time with their existing data analysts, data scientists, and data engineering teams to understand their needs and then have a tailored solution and then make sure you get the right the data tools and then like make sure the integration is much better so that way the teams can get started and make use of their data the best. So we just got started writing about the different case studies on our website datafarer.com and also we have our own LinkedIn page to follow. I think those are the places that we would want more people to reach.
So Pankaj, they just get a hold of you at datafarer.com. Is there an email you want to drop off on this on the podcast so people can know as well?
Yeah, you can actually, if you go to our website, there is a page where you can actually post a query or send an email. That's one way. If you write something there, we will be getting an email to both of us. That's one of the most efficient way. You don't have to kind of remember any email ID. Otherwise, you can be like, Pankaj, our first name, Pankaj at datafarer.com and Praveen at datafarer.com. So these are the two email IDs we can reach out to us. So.
Awesome. Before we end, this is it. Anything else you want to leave the audience with? I mean, we got deep into Iceberg. Whatever your background, there's so much more we covered. And for those listening, we prepared a lot more to give, but just we're running out of time. So Praveen, Pankaj, any last words you want to share with the audience?
In the whole podcast, we've been talking about open source and Apache Iceberg, but this is not the only thing we work on. I mean, we have kind of wealth of experiences and skills and kind of we're up to date with the new technologies, what's happening, all the developments happening in the data engineering world. So any of a person who's listening to this podcast have any issue with the data engineering, feel free to contact us and we can set up some time with you, maybe half an hour discussion to know, just to understand the problem rather than a solution or, what tools you should use. I mean, just to get to know your problem better. So what I feel is that if we know your problem better and structure the problem around, we can have more options to give you cost-effective solutions or solutions that actually fit into your ecosystem rather than something which is kind of, hey, you have X, you need Y. I mean, that's not the kind of, ready-baked solution we want to provide. We want to provide a customized cost-effective solution as per your needs, as per what we feel is suitable for you. I mean, there could be, people could have multiple opinions around that. I mean, we are open to that. But particularly, we want to solve customers' problem rather than push a solution down to their throat.
Very good. Praveen, any last words from you?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, we're in the age of AI and then like a lot of AI models getting built. But to have a really well-performing AI model, it's also crucial to have the right data sets. So that I think you could have a well-performing AI model when you have a high-quality data. So like that's where I think we could deliver like a lot of value in having the right data stack to have a good quality of data. So and this that way you could use this data to have a in-house any AI model.
Well, thank you both for your time. I think, you know, datafarer.com, reach out to them there. And we thank you for insights and joining today. It's been a pleasure having both of you on the show. For our listeners, if you want to learn more about Pankaj and Praveen's work on Apache Iceberg, we'll include some links on our notes as well so that you can be able to get a hold of them. Thank you for listening. Tune in for next episode. We're going to be speaking with an engineering manager from Walmart in our community. Please subscribe. And until next time, thank you for your time. Praveen and Pankaj, please stay on. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah. Thanks for having us, Steven. Thank you.
Thank you, Steven. Thank you for hosting us. It has been a pleasure to, you know, meet you and interact with you and show our views and you know, the way you actually, you know, moved around the various questions. It was just commendable. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.